Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Walnut Street. We are excited to see you. Glad y'all got out here in this cold weather. But in my opinion, there was snow, so it's worth it, right? Yeah, kind of. Okay. All right, if y'all stand, we're going to get started with worship within Christ alone. We're here to worship our God this morning, no matter what the weather looks like. Whether you're here or you're at home worshiping, we're here to worship our God. So let's do that this morning within Christ alone. In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are still, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless faith, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save, till on the cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay, light of the world by darkness slain, then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand, till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. I hope that you sing those words with truth this morning. I know sometimes I do it. I get caught up in just singing the words just because I know the song and I sing the words without thinking about them. But I hope that you sang that with truth, that you truly believe that once you are a believer, nothing can take that away from you. But that's only true if you're a believer. Let's continue in worship with Revelation Song.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Holy, holy is he. Sing a new song to him who sits on heaven's mercy seat. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God of living color, flashes of lightning, rolls of thunder, blessing and honor, strength and glory and power be to you, the only wise King. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you. Filled with wonder, awestruck wonder, at the mention of your name. Jesus, your name is power, breath and living water, such a marvelous mystery. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Let's sing the chorus one more time.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. With all creation I sing praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything, and I will adore you.
Amen. We're going to finish with the song, Shout to the Lord, singing to our God this morning and worshiping him directly. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there's none like you.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. my Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hands. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you.
Amen. You can be seated.
I want to welcome you to Walnut Street this morning, and glad you're here despite the cold weather. But I guess if it's going to be cold, like Lindsay said, at least there's some snow on the ground. And really, that's not snow, people. That's East Texas snow. We got to spend several years in Lubbock out there in West Texas, and there was some winters we would have like 12-foot snow drifts and stuff. So, and I went and dove in it. I'm glad you're here. If you're a guest with us, we welcome you, of course. And if you wouldn't mind filling out the visitor card in front of you, we would appreciate that. As you can tell, there's a lot of people out. There's a lot of people out everywhere. So continue to be in prayer for those who are sick and with the COVID stuff still going around. I guess we just need to accept that this is the world we're going to live in and just move on with it, right? That's the way it's going to be. But there have been a few others, the Attaways and the Andersons, who have, I guess this week, have gotten it. So just be in prayer for each other and ask that God takes care of everyone. A couple of announcements, just really reminders. First off, there's still a lot of mail for everybody. There's a lot of Christmas cards, it looks like, still over in the mailboxes over here in this little office. So if you wouldn't mind going by and checking your box out and being sure to pick all that stuff up. Something else, if you look on the right side of the bulletin or underneath today, those of you that signed up for the shut-in ministry, I just want to meet with y'all real quick about what I'm kind of looking for there. And if you'll just stay after the service, I promise it won't be a long meeting. And I want to give you all the list and phone numbers and everything, but we'll talk about that. We also have business meeting tonight after the evening service. And tonight, by the way, our Revelation study is getting towards the end. And tonight's probably the biggest chapter of the whole thing, chapter 20, with the millennium. And so if you're interested in that, we'll meet tonight at 5. One other thing I wanted to mention just below under looking ahead. You see on the 23rd, which is next Sunday, Family Sunday. And that's something I've talked with some of the Sunday school teachers about. And it's something that I would like to add to what we do here during our worship services. So we had the missions thing where we look at our missionaries at the beginning of the month. And at the end of the month, what I'd like to do is what we'll just call Family Sunday. And instead of, we'll still have the nursery, so don't panic if you have babies. But instead of having our kids leave the service, just on that one Sunday, instead of having them leave, I want them to stay in here with us. And if they can, sit with their families. And that way they get comfortable and they understand what all this is about. And you see there's a children's time. I'll do a special lesson with them up on stage. I want to call them up here and do that. And I'll have other people do that as well. So I just wanted to make you aware that's what that is. So next Sunday, we're going to start that. It's going to normally be on the last Sunday of every month, but the last Sunday of this month, I've got something else going on. So we got to bump that up. So next week, be sure the kids are here, and we'll do all that. We'll worship with our families. I think that's a good thing. Just once a month. I don't think I missed anything else. Tell you what, let's stand. And let's go ahead and greet one another. As you're making your way back to your seats, if you wouldn't mind staying standing for our scripture. And everything has been, the songs have lined up perfectly with what we're going to talk about here in a minute. And this psalm is actually going to help lead the way as well. But Psalm 24, 1 through 2, and then verse 10. The earth is the Lord's and all its fullness, the world and those who dwell therein. For he has founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Then verse 10. Who is this King of glory? The Lord of hosts. He is the King of glory. And that just reminds us of something that we're going to need to be reminded of here in a minute. And then the nations of this world, the governments of this world need to be reminded of is that God and God alone is God. And God alone is King.
Amen.
And I'll share more about that here in a moment. But let's pray, and let's just thank God for who He is. Well, God, again, I thank You for allowing us to be here, and for everyone who's able to be here in person. We have a lot of people dealing with all kinds of afflictions and sickness and this COVID stuff, Lord. We know You're in total control, and just ask that You would help us to trust You in all things. We pray that everything that we do today is for Your honor and glory alone, that our minds and hearts are focused on You and not on ourselves. Father, we thank You for who You are. We thank You for being the sovereign God. We thank You for being the Creator. We thank You, Lord, that the buck stops with You and You call the shots in all things. It's not man. Please help us to live that truth. Help us to believe it and help us to share that truth with others. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
And I really enjoyed the praise
music this morning. All those songs were awesome. No better way to start out the service. And I hope you'll grab a hymnal and turn with me to number 54. Number 54, We Bring the Sacrifice of Praise. We'll sing through this twice.
We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy.
Let's sing that again.
We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. We bring the sacrifice of praise into the house of the Lord. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of thanksgiving. And we offer up to you the sacrifices of joy.
All right, if you would, turn a few pages over to number 147. Number 147. I stand amazed.
I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he can love me, a sinner condemned and clean.
Third.
He took my sins and my sorrows. He made them his very own. He bore a burden to Calvary and suffered and died alone. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous. Savior's love for me. When with the ransom in glory his face I glad shall see, 'twill be my joy through the ages to sing of his love for me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me.
Amen. All right. I hope we all stand amazed at that. That a perfect, holy God loved us enough to send his Son to die for us. And, you know, that we can have fellowship with a holy God because of that death, because of the blood that was shed. That is amazing. We should stand amazed, shouldn't we? I hope we all think about that and you know, are constantly amazed at God's goodness, the mercy that he pours out on us each and every day that we don't deserve. All right, if you would turn to number 742. Number 742. We'll sing all three verses. When upon life's billows.
When upon life's pillars you are tempest tossed, when you are discouraged thinking all is lost, capture many blessings, name them one by one, and it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one, count your many blessings, see what God hath done. Are you ever burdened with a load of care? Does the cross seem heavy you are called to bear? Count your many blessings, every doubt will fly, and you will be singing as the days go by. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings. take them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done. So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be discouraged, God is over all. Count your many blessings, and just live until God will forgive you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God hath done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God hath done.
All right. That's what happens when you get to singing and you're not looking at the book. You're just singing and you don't, it's not right, you know. But anyway, I apologize, but I was kind of getting into the music there. That's a good thing. That's a good thing. All right, if you would, turn with me to number 851. It's going to be our last song today. And we're going to sing I'll Fly Away.
Some glad morning when this life is over, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away
in the morning
when I die. Hallelujah, bye and bye. I'll fly away when the shadows of this life have grown.
Thank y'all. I think Mr. Cofer is going to bring a special today, and I think Seth and Kobe are going to help him. Luke was supposed to help him, but Luke ended up being out of town today, and I'm going to fill in for Luke.
Tell me of a home where no storm clouds rise. Oh, they tell me of it
This pulpit mic might be a little hot.
I can hear it ringing, and I'm not even saying anything yet. Well, that was cool. Four generations on one stage. I don't mean to make you feel old, Junior. Okay. At least you admit it. That's a cool thing, and that's one reason why I want to do Family Sundays. You get to see that. So today we just started studying Ecclesiastes last week, and then events that have taken place in our world and over here in North America has kind of changed what we were going to do today. And I don't know if you followed the news much. I don't think this has really been covered a whole lot, if at all. Lindsay and I don't do a whole lot of news these days. But there's legislation in Canada called Bill C-4. And ironically, it's named C-4 because what it basically seeks to do is blow up how God defines identity or gender identity, how God defines human sexuality, how God defines marriage. And as of January 8th, it is now criminal in Canada to counsel against those sinful feelings and those sinful desires. And if you're caught doing that, you will actually serve prison time. Today, in fact, I'm going to read you a letter here in a second that kind of started all this, what we're doing today. By the way, you were a part of a unique day today. But there will be pastors today in Canada who will be put in prison for what they will preach. And I want to read to you a letter that came. I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I want to read you enough to where you all understand what's going on and why we're doing what we're doing, going over who God is, the C-4 bill, and our Canadian brothers. But this first part, it was actually put out by probably the most well-known Protestant voice in our nation at this time is John MacArthur over in California, fighting the good fight over there. He's been the pastor at Grace Community Church for over 50 years now. He starts the letter this way: "Dear Minister of the Gospel, I write to you to call your attention to an urgent matter in which the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ is under attack. On December 22nd, I received an email from Pastor James Coates of Grace Life Church of Edmonton in Alberta, Canada. You will remember that he was recently imprisoned for keeping his church open during COVID-19 lockdowns. James's recent email gave me insight into the Canadian government's decision to pass Bill C-4, which directly, and this is quote, directly comes against parents and counselors who would seek to offer biblical counsel with respect to sexual immorality and gender. James indicates that it could be used to criminalize evangelism. And then to clarify the bill, James forwarded this email from Pastor Andrew De Bartolo. And this is from the Canadian side. Thank you so much for your willingness not only to shine a light on the situation here in Canada, but also your partnership in calling other men to preach on biblical sexuality on January 16th in unity and solidarity with ministers here in Canada. And that's what we're doing today. Bill C-4 passed through the House and the Senate without opposition. Not a single dissenting vote was cast by any member of the Conservative Party. It received royal assent on December 8th, which means it will come into law after January 8th, 2022. The bill will amend the criminal code in Canada to ban conversion therapy. It will criminalize, among other things, quote, causing another person to undergo conversion therapy, promoting or advertising conversion therapy. In the preamble of the bill, it says that the belief that, quote, heterosexuality, cisgender gender identity, and gender expression that conforms to the sex assigned to a person at birth is a myth. According to Canadian laws of January 8th, 2022, the belief in God's design for marriage and sexuality will now be seen as a myth. The bill can clearly be used against any preacher or elder who either speaks against homosexuality or transgenderism, or who counsels a person to obey Christ and abandon their homosexual transgender actions and lifestyle. This means as of January 8th, 2022, it will be against the law to preach, teach, or counsel regarding God's design for marriage and sexuality. And then it finishes with an actual quote from the bill. Everyone who knowingly causes another person to undergo conversion therapy, including by providing conversion therapy to that other person, is guilty of an indictable offense and liable to imprisonment for a term of not more than 5 years. Similarly, everyone who knowingly promotes or advertises conversion therapy is guilty of an indictable offense and liable to imprisonment for a term of not more than 2 years. And it ends this way. On January 16, 2022, which is today, faithful men across this country and many in the United States will be preaching on God's design for marriage and a biblical ethic of sexuality. We will be doing so illegally, declaring to the state that there is one God and one Lord over His church, and that Christ alone gets to both define marriage and dictate what is required in the pulpit. We are honored that our American brothers will be joining us in this. I'm not one to join in on movements or just to do something, which is what a lot of people tend to do these days. But there's, you know, after praying a lot about this, there's just something Pauline about it. It feels like Paul wrote that letter. And really, what's really interesting and neat about it to me is something like this that's happening in our side of the world. This is something that really makes the New Testament stuff jump off the page to me. So this is exactly the same stuff Paul was doing. Writing letters to churches saying, we're in this fight together, we need to stand for truth. Everybody around us hates it, they hate you, and they're going to mistreat you. But we must stand for truth. And today, here we are. After praying a lot about it, I decided to sign my name to it, and we're going to stand with them today. Amen. Next week, we'll return to our regularly scheduled program of Ecclesiastes. But today, that's what we're going to do. This topic is going to be heavy, but at the same time, the stuff that we're going to look at, this right here today is the line. And it's in Canada. There are already bills similar to it in California, New Jersey, New York, and Nevada. It's here. And one day it'll be in Texas. And I guarantee you one day it'll be even in Winnsboro. We don't know how long that'll be. We don't know how many years. It could be even shorter. But nonetheless, the time is now for you and I to decide as the church and as Christians if we're going to side with God or if we're going to side with man. If you side with man, it'll be a lot easier for you. But if you side with God, you actually will gain honor and you will gain a reward and you will gain something so much more everlasting and so much greater than what this world can offer you. So that's what we're going to do. I just kind of thinking about this, I asked the question, and it's in your notes if you're taking them. Why does God get to tell me who I am? And that's really the big debate. And the line is either God gets to tell me who I am and gets to tell me who human beings are, or I get to decide that. And the majority of our world, Canada, has decided that man gets to decide who man is. So what I want to do is first, I just want to read off verse after verse after verse after verse. Not comment on anything, but I encourage you, if you have some time, go read Isaiah chapters 40 through 48. And in those chapters, God tells you exactly who He is. I'm just going to share with you some of the surface. Isaiah 40, 12 through 18. Who has measured the waters in the hollow of His hand, measured heaven with a span, and calculated the dust of the earth in a measure, weighed the mountains in scales and the hills in a balance? Who has directed the Spirit of the Lord, or has His counselor has taught Him? With whom did He take counsel, and who instructed Him? and taught him in the path of justice, who taught him knowledge and showed him the way of understanding. Behold, the nations are as a drop in a bucket and are counted as the small dust on the scales. Look, he lifts up the isles as a very little thing. And Lebanon is not sufficient to burn, nor its beasts sufficient for a burnt offering. All nations before him are as nothing, and they are counted by him less than nothing and worthless. To whom then will you liken God? Or what likeness will you compare to him? Isaiah 42:8, I am the Lord, that is my name, and my glory I will not give to another, nor my praise to carved images. Isaiah 43:10-13, you are my witnesses, says the Lord, and my servant whom I have chosen, that you may know and believe me and understand that I am he. Before me there was no God formed, nor shall there be after me. I am the Lord, and besides me there is no Savior. I have declared and saved, I have proclaimed, and there was no foreign God among you. Therefore you are my witnesses, says the Lord, that I am God. Indeed, before the day was, I am he, and there is no one who can deliver out of my hand. I work, and who will reverse it? Isaiah 44:6-8, thus says the Lord, the King of Israel, and his Redeemer, the Lord of hosts, I am the first and I am the last. Besides me there is no God, and who can proclaim as I do? Then let him declare it and set it in order to me, since I appointed the ancient people, and the things that are coming and shall come, let them show these to them. Do not fear nor be afraid. Have I not told you from that time and declared it? You are my witnesses. Is there a God besides me? Indeed, there is no other rock. I know not one. Isaiah 44:24, thus says the Lord your Redeemer, and he who formed you from the womb, I am the Lord who makes all things, who stretches out the heavens all alone, who spreads abroad the earth myself. Isaiah 45:5-7, I am the Lord and there is no other. There is no God besides me. I will gird you, though you have not known me, that they may know from the rising of the sun to its setting that there is none besides me. I am the Lord and there is no other. I form the light and create darkness. I make peace and create calamity. I, the Lord, do all these things. Isaiah 45:18, for thus says the Lord, who created the heavens, who is God, who formed the earth and made it, who has established it, who did not create it in vain, who formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Isaiah 45:21-22, tell and bring forth your case. Yes, let them take counsel together. Who has declared this from ancient time? Who has told it from that time? Have not I the Lord? There's no other God besides me, a just God and a Savior. There is none besides me. Look to me and be saved, all you ends of the earth, for I am God and there is no other. Isaiah 46:5, to whom will you liken me and make me equal and compare me that we should be alike? Isaiah 46:9-10, remember the former things of old, for I am God and there is no other. I am God and there is none like me, declaring the end from the beginning and the ancient times, things that are not yet done, saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure. Isaiah 48:3, I have declared the former things from the beginning. They went forth from my mouth, and I caused them to hear it. Suddenly I did them, and they came to pass. Isaiah 48:5, even from the beginning I have declared it to you. Before it came to pass, I proclaimed it to you, lest you should say, my idol has done them, and my carved image and my molded image have commanded them. And the last, Isaiah 48:11-13, for my own sake, for my own sake, I will do it. For how should my name be profaned? And I will not give my glory to another. Listen to me, O Jacob and Israel, my called. I am he, I am the first, I am also the last. Indeed, my hand has laid the foundations of the earth, and my right hand has stretched out the heavens. When I call to them, they stand up together. We are God's creation in God's world. Because of that, he calls all the shots, not us. And this is where we have to start, because if we're going to define who gets to say who I am as a human being, and this debate, who gets to say what human sexuality is, you have to start with who God is. And he clearly says, I'm the one that calls that shot. So if you're taking notes, this is where we start. God is the only God in existence. There is no other God or power greater than him. He is the ultimate and final authority over all things. That's what you get from Isaiah and from the entire scripture. So that's going to be your argument. Either I'm going to stand with God and what he says, or I'm going to stand with man and what he says. There's two sides to it. And there's a very clear line. Either God is God or he's not. Isaiah 6, 1 through 3, I want to show you this before we get into the other notes, and they'll be really fairly rapid fire. Isaiah 6, 1 through 3, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. Above it stood seraphim. Each one had six wings, which with two he covered his face, two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one cried to another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. That holy, holy, holy is the only, God is the only one that's ascribed to. Other things are called holy, but nothing else and no other being, including the creatures that you read about, including the angels, nothing else is ever said to be holy, holy, holy. That's only for God. And I want to show you what that means. So when he says, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts, if you were Isaiah and you were receiving this vision and you heard it in Hebrew, it sounded like this. Kadosh, 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 Yehovah Saba. And what that would mean in English, gave it to you up there, is God is the sacred and set apart, sacred and set apart, sacred and set apart one, the endless one, or the existing one over all things. That's God. And since God is the holy, holy, holy one, God is the only one that gets to tell you and I who we are and are not. And we can't tell him otherwise, because we are not the holy, holy, holy one. And that's where the line is drawn. You either believe that or you don't. And if you do believe that, that's the side you must be on. Or you're just over here and you don't know it. You have to confess this. So one after the other here. Because of who God is, this is where we start. God, number one, God has divine right to define all things. Because of who he is, because he's the holy, holy, holy one, and the almighty creator, he gets to define all things. And that settles it. That's it. We go to Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So because the holy, holy, holy one, the Jehovah, the existing one, the one that exists outside of time, the one that exists outside any human limitation, since he created it all, he's the boss. Then from there, you gradually follow this train of thought, and we'll get to human sexuality. But letter A, or underneath that first point, since God can define all things for our purposes today, we'll talk about this. God defines humanity. God gets to say who humans are. And you go to Genesis 1:25 through 28. God made the beast of the earth according to its kind, cattle according to its kind, everything that creeps on the earth according to its kind, and God saw that it was good. That was after he made the land animals. And then God said, this is day 6 of creation, let us make man in our image according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the flesh of the sea, over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. And then God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, over every living thing that moves on the earth. So when God created in the 6 days of creation, rested on the seventh, you notice very clearly that of all his creation, mankind was created different. Mankind is the special crowning jewel of his creation. And he said, I'll make him in the likeness of us. I'm going to make him in our image, the Holy Trinity, the triune God. And this word here, let us make man. It's the word Adam, or as we say in English, Adam. Adam represents mankind. Now let's make man. And this creature you notice about mankind just there in the creation narrative, then chapter 2 details all that. But you see the difference between mankind when he's created and animals and everything else? Is that mankind is not only made in the image of God, mankind is given dominion to rule over this earth. We rule over the animals and the plants and all that stuff. But we're the rulers here underneath the rulership of God, and that's how God defined who we would be. We are not animals. That flies in the face of evolution. We are not like the animals. We are above them. And so many other things you could say there, but for our purposes about being humans, this special creation called human is unique in three ways. This is how we're mostly unique compared to everything else created, including everything out in the cosmos. First, man was created in the image of God himself. Nothing else was created in the image of God, just man. That's likeness or similar to. Next, what also makes human unique is human or man was brought to life by the breath of God. God's breath actually gave life to this creation that he would call man. See that in Genesis 2:7. Animals don't have that. Planets don't have that. Planets don't have that. Just man. And then finally, humans were given authority to rule over all creation under God. It would be great if our nation realized that we are a nation under God, whether we realize it or not. We need to get back to that. But you see, these three things that make us unique. We're made in the image of God. God actually breathed his spirit of life into us, and we have dominion to rule under his authority over this whole thing. That's who he said we would be as humans. And then from there, the details come. Next part of your notes, if you're taking them, is after God defines humanity, God defines human image. It's a big debate right now what human image actually is. Verse 26, first part, God said, "Let us," Father, Son, Spirit, "let us make man in our image according to our likeness." And what likeness means there in the Hebrew is similitude or similar to. There's some dangerous teaching out there today that says we are all little gods. We're not running around like little gods. We're just made similar to God. I'll explain that in a second. But it's one thing that makes us different than the animals. One thing that makes us different than the rest of creation. We're made in the image of not just God, but Father, Son, Spirit. So if there's three, there must be some kind of three to us. Well, there is. You and I are one being, just like God is one being. But what makes God unique is he's able to present himself in three persons, right? He's one being, one nature, but three different persons. And only an eternal God could ever do that. There's no human being that I can never express myself as three different Ryans. I can only be one, and that's how I'm limited. An eternal God can exist in three different persons and still be one being. So how are you and I similar to God if we're just one being? And what makes us different than the animals? Mind or a consciousness, a physical body, and an eternal spirit. Did you know that about yourself? The animals don't have that. The animals have a body, and the animals just react. The animals do not have a soul that needs to be saved. When God breathed the spirit of, when he breathed his spirit into us to give us life, that was our spirit. That's what lives on. When we die here on this earth and we bury somebody, the mind shuts down and dies. The body decays and dies. But the spirit lives on forever. You don't actually ever die. That's what makes us unique. Made in the image of God, we're a three-part being. And if you take one part away of the Trinity, for example, you take Father away, it's not God. You take the Son, Jesus, away, it's not God. Spirit, same thing with us. You take the mind away, you're dead. You take the body away, you're dead. You take the spirit away, you're dead. You got to have all three parts. We're made similar to God. So he gets to define our image. All people are made in the image of God, even the worst most evil, sinister person on this earth was still made in the image of God. And that's how you and I as Christians in the church should view people. Next, after he defines humanity, he defines our image, God defines human distinction. Next verse, verse 27, God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him. Male and female, he created them. That's probably one of the biggest debates we have going on right now. And so God said he created man in his image, and he said that when he created man in his image, he didn't just make a man. We're not just all a bunch of men running around. He also didn't just make woman. There's not just a bunch of women running around. What did he do? He said that he decided in his will, in his sovereignty, to properly display who I am, what my image is on this earth that I created. I need a man and a woman. And he fashioned them that way. Why is that? Well, to display God, you have to have a man and a woman to do that. If it was just a world full of men, you would only ever have the masculine characteristics of God. Well, when you read the Bible and look at the Hebrew words of his might and his righteousness and his power and his sovereignty, those are written in masculine terms in the Hebrew. But you also read about his love and his mercy and his grace and his kindness and his patience. Guess how those are written? In the feminine. And so to properly display who he is in his world, he made a man and he made a woman. And that's the key issue to all this stuff, to homosexuality, transgenderism, gender reassignment. That right there is the big issue. We could stop now if we wanted to. And we don't really talk about that one. We talk about all this other stuff. But this is the big issue. The issue isn't that we hate that sin. The issue is that we hate the people. The issue is, if we decide to start changing what man and woman is, if we decide to start changing what marriage is, then we're directly violating why God created us in the first place. Amen. It's to worship him and to show this world who he is. You cannot do that in homosexuality or transgenderism. Two men cannot do that. Two women cannot do that. You need a man and a woman. And God said so, not us. I just want to show you these three deals here and then we'll move on. You see there in verse 27, he says, man. I want to show you how simple this would be. I mean, this is easy to say, right? But if the world just believed in Christ and followed God's design, look at what this simple verse would solve. Okay? So again, verse 27, he created man in his own image, the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them. Man. If we just all realized that God created man in his image, we'd be done with the racist problem. Because it's only one race, human. And that's how he designed it. You don't see any concept whatsoever in the Bible, Old or New Testament, white race, black race, red race, blue race, purple race. We made that up. And it's a part of our, I say, Christians and churches, and Christian people use that language all the time. You know, we have this race and that race. No, there's no biblical concept of other races. There's one race. There's just different people. And that's something else that's very unique about the creation of God when he made man. God is spirit. God is not a man sitting up there in the heavens. So God being spirit is not going to be represented by a white man. He's not going to be represented by just a black man, by just a red man, by just a brown man. There's so much diversity because that's God. He's not defined by one color or creed or culture. And when we're all in the heavens one day, all believers, we'll be all together, and that will be the full representation of God. Not just man and woman, but all the different types of people. If this world just realized that God created man in his image, we wouldn't have the problem with racism. Because you just see everybody as man. Then it says God created him. That simply shows who's in charge. God created man, not anything else, not even evolution. That would solve the origins and the idolatry problems. Because if God created us and we recognize that, we wouldn't make all these other gods up. He'd be the only one. And then finally, male and female. Well, we got that debate going on all day long in our culture, but if the world just realized that there's only two God-ordained expressions of mankind, that would take care of the whole gender fluidity, gender identity debate. God's defined it. We got to decide which side we stand on. From there, after distinction, God defines human gender roles. This one's a fun conversation, even in churches. God defines human gender roles, Genesis 2:18 and then verses 21 to 24. The Lord God said, "It's not good that man should be alone. I will make him a helper comparable to him." And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh in its place. Then the rib which the Lord God had taken from man, he made into a woman. He brought her to the man. And Adam said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore a man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." So of the two genders, you know, God's defined it all the way down. And now he gets to the two genders, and he actually tells us, this is what the two genders are. And I define that. And so just go down the list. Men and women, first off, are equal in humanity. He takes her from the side. You've probably heard that. Not from the head so she lords over him, not from the feet so that she's a slave. Took him from his side. And you notice she's made comparable to him. Not less than, not more than. Men and women are equal in humanity. That would have solved a lot of issues, especially in our nation's past. It would solve the feminism issue for sure. Next, man has the lead role. This is one of the things that our human nature doesn't like to hear. But as far as God's designed it, and under the idea, again, that they're equal in humanity, God still says man has the lead role. And you notice in those verses, it's man who leaves his parents. It's man who seeks out a wife. It's man who comes together with his wife and makes one flesh. Man provides, he loves, he protects the woman as he would his own body. And we're going to look at Ephesians in a second. And then when the man marries the woman, they become one unit. No longer individuals that have their own agenda, but they're one flesh. And from there, God defines that the woman has the support role. And again, they're equal in humanity, but the woman has the support role in God's design. And we need to understand when he's talking about a helper comparable to Adam, that's not a less than or inferior role to Adam. Simply put, it's kind of like if you were, I don't know if you heard this when you were kids, but I did, because I said so. After we've already looked at who God is through Isaiah 40 through 48, we ought to be able to sit back and say, well, because I may not like it, but God says so. Because he's a little bit bigger than me. But he gives the woman the support role. This does not make woman helpless. Man is to shoulder the main load while the woman is to support and be a helper. And you just think about how that works itself out in the real world. When this relationship is messed up, when man's not leading, woman's not supporting, all that stuff gets messed up, or when they're on their own for whatever reasons, don't those relationships and just life in general get a lot more stressful? And in our world, that's what you see. You see, not just with redefining everything and marriage and all that, but just simply with sin. There are so many men out there not doing their God-ordained job, and they're miserable. There's so many women out there not doing their God-ordained job, and they're miserable. If we just did things the way God called us to, and I kind of put it like this, just thinking about it, as one unit, when the man fails to lead or he refuses to let the woman support, the unit breaks down. When the woman fails to support or when she attempts to take the lead from the man, that happens, the unit breaks down. We got our roles, we just need to do them. And then finally we get to this, men and women fulfilling their God-given roles, which are lead and support. Within a marriage, properly displays Christ's relationship to his church. And so it's not just a, especially with the whole redefining marriage issue, it's not just a God image thing. It's that if you don't marry the way God called us to marry, we can't show this world who Jesus is properly, and we can't show them his relationship to his church properly. Two men cannot do that. Two women cannot do that. And that's how he defined it. Ephesians 5, 22 through 25, this is why. Wives, submit to your own husbands as to the Lord. I'm not going to take the time to touch that today, so you'll just have to stew over that one. For the husband is head of the wife, but notice, pay close attention to the language, because people want to get so mad, especially feminists, want to get so mad right there. He ain't the head of me. Well, look at how he's the head. Okay? As also Christ is head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. You see the relationship? Just think about your own relationship with the Lord Jesus. Does he beat you over the head every day and command that you do this or that, or I'm not going to love you anymore, or whatever? No. There's so much freedom in a life lived for Christ. That's what marriage is supposed to display. And then the other end of that for men, husbands, love your wives just as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for her. So what does that say about the, about men? Husbands, just like Christ is to the church, Christ is invested in his church. He loves his church to the point where he would give his own life up for the church, and he did. He would never leave his church. He would never forsake his church. He doesn't keep a record of wrongs and sins against his church. All the things that Jesus is to the church, that's what man is to be to his wife. And if we just did what God said, this world would get it. What's the big deal with these church people and this Jesus? Oh, I can tell by their marriages. So we get to this point and then the final. So Ephesians 5 tells us this about sexual identity. Homosexual, transgender, gender fluid, and even polygamous marriages where there's more than one spouse, those relationships cannot display the relationship of Christ to his church. And that's why, among many reasons, we as Christians cannot accept them. Not that you hate the people and don't accept the people, but we can't bow to this agenda. And it's not because of, you know, my own personal feelings are at stake. It's because God's image is at stake. And we should be willing, like these Canadian pastors who are going to jail today, we should be willing to take that, you know, whatever comes with it, because God's more important to us than this life here. These relationships reject God's design. And here's the final point. So since God gets to define all of this, the last part here is God defines any sinful deviancy from his order for human sexuality as divine judgment. It's not just that it's wrong. When all this stuff starts happening and people start doing this and like Canada makes this law, that's clear indication they're not just doing wrong and sinning. God has put them under his judgment. And only destruction is going to follow. So Romans 1, 24 through 32 is the passage we'll go to for this. Therefore, and this is the process, and the whole thing is when man or a nation rejects God, here's the pattern. So therefore, God also gave them up to uncleanness in the lust of their hearts to dishonor their bodies among themselves, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie and worshipped and served the creature rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. Do you see why people get into homosexuality and why they get into transgenderism? Why we're seeing parents telling their five-year-old kid it's okay to have gender reassignment surgery? All this stuff that you and I as Christians just don't understand, we can't wrap our mind around. Do you see why they're doing it? God gave them up to it. What God does in judgment is when people decide, I don't want God, God removes His grace. We all live under common grace. That's the only reason that this world's not tearing itself apart and we're all still here. He removes His grace from people who routinely reject Him, and all He does is have at it. When you see people doing this stuff, abortion, when you see people doing these things that you can't wrap your Christian mind around, it's because they've been fully given over to what their sinful mind and sinful heart have always wanted to do. But then they finally rejected God, and now He gives them full reign. You see what this world would be like if God was not sovereign? It'd be a scary place. So I'll move on. This reason God gave them up to vile passions, for even their women exchanged the natural use for what is against nature. Likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the woman, burned in their lust for one another, men with men committing what is shameful, and receiving in themselves the penalty of their error which is due. And that part's very easy to see among many other things. HIV and AIDS is astronomically higher in gay relationships between men. They don't tell you that on TV. These men are absolutely miserable and in pain and very sick. And they're not going to tell you that. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a debased mind, which is the last stage, to do those things which are not fitting. And then there's this whole list. It's not just homosexual stuff. It's all kinds of sins. When God finally gives someone over to their mind and what they want, being filled with all unrighteousness, sexual immorality, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, evil-mindedness. They are whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, violent, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, undiscerning, untrustworthy, unloving, unforgiving, unmerciful, who, knowing the righteous judgment of God. Everybody knows in their heart there's a judgment day coming. But even though they know that, those who practice such evil things are deserving of death. They even realize that. They not only do the same things, but they also approve of those who practice them. Do you see that play out every single day in our world? And now you know why, if you didn't already. It's because God's just finally said, you reject me, fine, have at it. And that's not a good place to be. So, you know, kind of wrapping things up, and seeing what Canada just did, enacting the C4 bill, which will throw people in jail who just, if someone comes to you saying, you know, I'm having homosexual feelings, or I'm a man but I want to be a woman, you are now going to be thrown in jail in Canada if you try to counsel them away from that and even lovingly try to show them, this is who God made you to be, let me help you. You have to bow to their fleshly desires, and if you don't, you'll be thrown in jail for 5 years. If you simply promote it, and say, hey, yeah, I think this is a good idea. Or, yeah, this is what needs to happen. You can be thrown in jail for 2 years. You wonder, how in the world could any government think any of that's good? They've been given over to a debased mind. And debased mind, this is what this means. So we're all clear. It's an unfit mind. It's a mind that doesn't do what it's supposed to do. So when you see these things, for example, I saw a video the other day. These people were interviewing college students, and this one college student said there was over 100 genders. And you sit there and laugh, but at the same time, it's like, that's really sad. That's on a college campus where learning is happening. If someone genuinely believes there's over 100 genders, totally denying biology, that's a debased mind. The only way a society can cheer and celebrate a 7-year-old girl choosing to have gender reassignment surgery and wants to be a boy, and the parents praising their daughter for that, that's a debased mind. The only way the FDA can believe it's a good and moral service to provide abortion pills because COVID's keeping the abortion clinics closed, that's a debased mind. And then something like the C4 bill, where people are just trying to give God's truth and help them and show them the love of Jesus, you now get thrown in jail for it, that's a debased mind. So this is the conclusion of the matter. I'll just go over the points one more in case you missed anything, and I'll leave you with a question and I'll pray. This is the conclusion of all of it, and this is where we must choose to stand, on this side or the other. God is the only God in existence. There is no other God or power greater than Him. He is the ultimate and final authority over all things. And because of that, God has divine right to define all things. From there, God defines humanity. God defines image of the human. God defines human distinction. God defines human gender roles. And God defines any deviancy from that as divine judgment. So this is the question to you as I get ready to pray. Whenever we get C4'd, and we will, I don't remember what year it was, but I was sitting at the table at my mamaw's house talking to my papaw. It was early 2000s. And he told me there at the table that day, your generation of preachers will endure persecution. It's going to be through this LGBTQ stuff. And turns out he was right. When we get C4'd, what side are you going to stand on? And Canada is a good example. And you need to understand, Jesus says, count the cost. If you're going to stand with me, you're going to get thrown in jail. People are going to hate you because of me. Your churches are going to get fined. Your churches may even one day, they may have armed guards and chains on the door. Where are you going to stand? Is Jesus worth it enough to us? Let's pray. Father, I want to thank you for your grace this morning and the guidance of your Spirit. I know you already know this, Lord, but I was nervous about it. I wasn't sure what to say. Father, I want to pray to thank you first off for everyone who's in here. And I pray, Lord, as this stuff gets closer and closer to home, that we who claim to be Christians would be willing to take the stand that you've called us to. And apparently this is going to be our battle. The battle of sexual identity. I pray, Lord, that you would help us to be bold witnesses to this truth, but at the same time be loving people while we do it. Father, I'm sure all of us in this room either know somebody personally or we know of someone who believes identity is defined by man and not God. Please, Lord, help us to be the examples that we're called to be. Father, I want to pray for those who are in Canada and those pastors like James Coates, who has already been in prison for other reasons, who may be going back today. I want to thank you for their example and their courage. And I pray that we learn something from them. Father, please be with them as they suffer. I pray that you would be with those who have chosen to take the stand on your word and who will continue to counsel people with biblical counsel and steer them to you as their only hope and Savior. Father, I pray for the hearts of the Canadians. There's a lot of lost people there. It's a very lost country. And I pray that maybe, Lord, through this stance here in the U.S. and in Canada, that maybe this will start something. Father, strengthen your church, strengthen the Canadian brothers, give them wisdom, and be with their families. And finally, Lord, I want to lift up both of our governments. The Canadian government obviously has made its choice of who they say God is. And I pray, Lord, that you would do what you need to do to bring them to repentance. And Father, I pray the same for our nation. There's clearly a lot of ungodly things going on with our leadership, and they need to repent. Lord, I pray for those Christians that are in our government who are, they're trying, but they may not have the voice or the power that they need. I don't know. But I pray that they would be bold and they would be the examples that they should be and not worry whether it may cost them their political career. I pray that your name means more to them than that, but that's going to take a lot of strength. And I pray that you would work in them. Please be with us here at Walnut Street. Whenever this stuff, if it ever hits here full force, Lord, help us to be a church that'll stand and not fall. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we sing, told you it was a heavy subject today. But now there's a few things you can pray for. First off, we all need to be praying for our own personal strength in this, because it's easy to say, yeah, I'll stand, until you've got the authorities in your face. You and I need to be praying about that strength now before it gets here and it's too late to be praying for it. Maybe you need to pray for that. Maybe you know somebody, and I'm sure everybody does, who's wrapped up in all this, and they need to be saved out of it. Pray for them. And if nothing else, pray for Canada. And pray for those pastors who are going to be taken out of their churches today, away from their families, and being locked up in cells. So let's sing, and let's pray.
Pray 37. Thank you.